conversations here in the church between different ones or in a Bible study setting, and someone will be referencing a movie that's out, and, oh, it's a great movie, you got to go see it, or this is my favorite movie, what's your favorite movie? You know, those kind of conversations all of us have probably overheard or even participated in conversations like that. Well, I want to let you in on a little secret today that there's probably a few in here that already know this, but the majority of you don't know this. Though I do like Westerns, you know, I mean, I really do get some enjoyment out of watching, especially if Clint Eastwood's in it, you know, watching a Western. There's a few other Westerns that I enjoy as well. And I do get some enjoyment out of watching action movies, okay? There's some of those that can be pretty fun and I find relaxing to watch. Here's the thing. If you add an element of time travel to a movie, there's like a 95% chance I'm going to love that movie, okay? It's just that one component. When it gets thrown into a movie, I've been a science fiction buff since I was a little kid, you know, back in Lost in Space days, back in the 1960s. You know, I've enjoyed Lost in Space, or I've enjoyed sci-fi. I saw a Lost in Space rerun here a couple years ago, and it's really dorky. But you know, when you're 7 or 8 years old, man, it was great. You know, back at that time. But one of the reasons that I like science fiction as a general rule is that I feel like it engages the imagination. It helps you to kind of think outside the box. And I like that. But when you throw time travel into it on top of that, then it challenges you with, you know, trying to keep track and think through all the ramifications of the ripple effect and stuff like this, of how when someone travels back in time and how it could change so many different things. And some of you are sitting there, you're just like, man, you are weird, you know. But there's a few of you sitting out there that are like, hey, I get it. I enjoy that too. And that's just part of the way that I'm wired. Now, having said that, I need to say this. You know as well as I do that time travel can't happen, right? Those of you who nod your head, you're wrong. I got you. I set you up for that one. Because if I'm a prophet, and sometimes I feel like I am, I'm a prophet, I'm going to make a prediction here this morning that before a full week passes, you're going to travel in time. Let's do this, just to help prove a point. Next Saturday evening, set your clock back 1 hour, and when you wake up on Sunday morning, you'll find out your clock is the right time. You will have traveled an hour back in time. Okay. All right. I got you there. You didn't see that one coming. Okay, so time travel's not possible. But what if it was possible? Here's the question that is at the top of your outline today as we continue the Question of the Week series. If you could time travel, would you go back and do things differently? Two Sundays ago, I asked a question on the connection card that was very similar to that question. It was worded a tad different. It said, if you could travel back in time, would you change certain things about your past? Give an example, if you would, of what you would change. And there were several people, I don't know, 8 or 9 people that filled out their connection card 2 Sundays ago whose answer to that question was, no, I wouldn't. And they went on to explain that the things of my past, both the painful things and the bad decisions and all that, that's part of what has made me who I am today, and I'm happy with who I am today, and I wouldn't change it, okay? okay? So there were about 9 people that gave that response. And if you happen to be one of those people, more power to you. But I got to tell you, you were in the minority. Because the vast majority of people responded to that question by saying, oh, yes, I would. If I could go back in time and I could change something in the past, I would change it. Here are some examples. One person wrote down that if they could travel back in time, what they would change is that they would be much more intentional of being a better parent than what they were. Another person wrote down that if they could go back in time, one of the things that they would change is they would finish college. Another person said that what they would do different is they would share their feelings more with others. Another person, and I don't want to give much for details, you know, on this, but this person was pretty specific. They said that if they could go back in time, what they would change is that when they were in high school, they would not date so-and-so. Because there was a couple of very painful years, apparently. Another person wrote down that what they would change is they wouldn't sell their GTO. One person wrote an emphatic yes. They would go back in time to change things. And then when I asked for a specific example, they said, too many to list. Yeah. But the primary response, the most common response that was given was spiritual in nature. And it kind of fell into 3 different categories, but all of them, like I said, are spiritual in nature. For example, the majority of people that responded in regards to a spiritual response and saying yes, they would change something, what they specified is that they would accept Jesus earlier in their life than when they did. They wouldn't wait so long to become a Christian. Another response that kind of fell in line with that kind of thinking is a number of people said that they would take their Christian life more serious than they did. Some of them said specifically when they were in high school. Some said specifically when they were in college. Some didn't specifically say a period of time. They just said they would take their Christian life more seriously. And lastly, in regards to those kinds of answers, there were several people that responded by saying if they could go back in time, one of the things they would change is they would read the Bible more. And they would have gotten plugged into a church sooner than what they did. All right. Well, I'm sorry, but I don't have one of these to accommodate you in going back in time. If you know the classics, H.G. Wells, The Time Machine, this is a picture of the second movie that they made. I don't have a time machine that can take you back in time for obvious reasons. But in regards to all of this and this line of thinking, there are a couple of things that I want to share with you today. The first part of our message today has to do with establishing the right kind of attitude that we need to have in our minds in regards to time. Because the Bible does talk about that. And so I think it'd be good for us to spend a few minutes getting that established. Both Old Testament and New Testament is not just a New Testament thing or an Old Testament thing. And so I'm going to show you an example from both. And so that's going to be the first part of what we talk about. And let me give it this heading, because I believe that this is a principle that is taught in the Scripture, though if you look for a specific verse that says that verbatim, you're not going to find that verse in the Bible. But this is a concept, an attitude that is presented, that you have one life to live, so seize the moment. Take advantage of the opportunity that you have. Like I said, I want to show you an Old Testament and a New Testament verse. You may not realize this, but David isn't the only one that wrote Psalms. A guy that you will fully recognize his name, but you might be a little bit surprised that he was a psalm writer, was Moses. There's actually a psalm from Moses. Let me show you a verse of Psalm 90, verse 10, where Moses touches on the very thing that we're touching on today. He says, our lives last 70 years, or if we are strong, 80 years. Now, let me pause that for just a moment. 70 to 80 years, it sounds like that could have been written during our lifetimes, because it's during our lifetime that that's been the average span of life. I mean, a number of years ago, it might have been the low 70s, but nowadays we're pushing the upper end of that. Last I checked, and I didn't look into it this week, but the average lifespan for a female today is 80 years. And the average lifespan for a guy, and guys are closing the gap a little bit here, is late 70s, 78, maybe 79 years. And so what Moses is saying is very relevant in that regards to our lives. It says our lives will last 70 years, or if we are strong, 80 years. But then he goes on and says, even the best of them are struggle and sorrow. The pronoun them that he is referencing is years, the years of our life. He says even the best of those years involve struggle and sorrow. And if you look back over the shoulder of your life, and for some of you, you may only be able to look back 25 or 30 years. Others of you can look a whole lot longer than that. You can look at 50, 60, or maybe even more years than that. And you look back over your life, and you could probably find numerous examples. And the more time you spend, the longer the list would be of struggles and sorrows. You know, I'm 57 years old, and I look back over my life, and yeah, there's been some struggles. I mean, back when a lot of you in your 20s were just kind of really hitting your prime, hitting on all cylinders in your life and direction in life, was starting to come together and everything else, I was spending my time in waiting rooms of hospitals and under cobalt machines having radiation treatments and various surgeries and chemotherapy and, you know, as I was going through two rounds of cancer in my 20s. And especially 1987, where I spent the majority of my year, that year laid up. And so when I think about what Moses is referring to here, when he says that we look back at the past and we see struggles, and yeah, I can see some struggles. And that was probably one of the most difficult physically, you know, for me during that time. But you find examples of that as well, various things in your life. And sorrows, I mean, yeah, clearly there are sorrows. I guess in a lot of ways I've been really fortunate that, you know, both my parents are still alive. Dad's getting up there in years, but they're still alive. All my siblings are still alive. But as most of you know, when my son Josh passed away a little over a year and a half ago, that was, you know, that hit closer to home than anything had on that level before. You know, and I'll be honest with you, and some of you fully understand this because you too are going down this road or have gone down this road yourself, but there is hardly a day that goes by that I don't find myself thinking about him. Whether it be something I'll see in my office that'll trigger a memory or something in my house, or maybe in the middle of the night and I'm laying there and I can't sleep, and all of a sudden that's where my thoughts go. And so when Moses talks about even the best of our years, you know, have a bunch of struggles and have a bunch of sorrows in them, you know, if you stop and reflect on that a little bit, you can understand, you can appreciate what it is that he's saying. And then he says this, he ends the verse by saying, indeed, they pass quickly. Now, the pronoun they, again, is a reference to those years. They pass quickly and we fly away. Now, how many of you, the older you get, feel like time is flying? I remember when I was young, I'd hear people use that phrase, and I was just like, I have no clue what you're talking about. You know, I mean, it just didn't register. But it does register now. Because it does. It seems in the blink of an eye before you know it. You know, you're a year older, and time is flying. And so basically, you know, Moses is drawing reference to our lives and how our lives, you know, go quickly. And all of that leads him, two verses later, to making this statement. Actually, it's in the form of a prayer. He says to the Lord, teach us to number our days carefully so that we may develop wisdom in our hearts. So when he says teach us to number our days, he's talking about our days, weeks, our months, our years. Teach us to pay attention to the time that we have available in our life so that we may develop wisdom in our hearts, so that we might be smart about the way we approach living life, so that we don't waste our life, so that we'll be intentional, we'll be selective, we'll be thinking it through. We won't just be automatically doing what everyone else seems to be doing. We won't put our lives in autopilot and just do whatever comes natural. I mean, all of that stuff kind of illustrates what that prayer is about. Okay, so there's the Old Testament part of it. And there's other passages in the Old Testament, you know, that emphasize similar things. Let me take you to the New Testament. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 to 17 says, so then, be very careful how you live. Don't live like foolish people, but like wise people. Make the most of your opportunities, because these are evil days. Now, he's not talking like these are satanic days or there's demons that are waiting in the corridors of your life. That's not what he's talking about here. When he says, make the most of your opportunities because these are evil days, he's basically saying, days are working against you here. You don't have as many as what you may think, what you may be taking for granted that you have. You don't have an endless supply of days, okay? That's the point being made. So make the most of your opportunities because these are evil days. So don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord wants. And so the basic concept here that is emphasized is we need to be careful. Be careful how you live. Be careful how you approach a given day, a given week, a given month, a given year in your life. Don't be careless in the way that you go about doing it. And the word that he uses a couple of times in those three verses is foolish. You don't want to be foolish. You don't want to be like foolish people. Now, when we, in our mind's eye, think about what a foolish person, a person that is being careless about the way they approach life, and so they are, in the end, being foolish about it, some of the images that come into our mind is we maybe think about someone who is addicted. Someone's addicted to drugs, or they're addicted to alcohol, and their life is a mess, and they've created pain for other people around them. Or we think about someone that's spending their time on Skid Row because of some poor choices or whatever that they've made in their life. And so that's kind of the types of images sometimes that come into our mind. And to one degree or another, some of that might be true in illustrating foolishness. But I find it very interesting how our Lord references what a foolish life looks like. In Luke chapter 12, and I'm only going to show you one verse here, but I'll invite you to study this further following this morning. In Luke chapter 12, verse 15, Jesus says this, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. So he's trying to help clarify in people's minds that the essence of life, the substance of life, as it was intended to be lived, it's not about materialism, okay? And then he goes on and he tells a story, and this is what you can read, but I'll paraphrase the story. He tells a story about a man that by 21st century standards was an incredible success at life. He was a man who excelled. He was a man that pretty much everything he touched turned to gold. I mean, he had an abundance. He was expanding. He was able to retire early, or at least extremely comfortable he was able to retire because he had been so successful. But as Jesus is telling the story about this man, he goes on to say that the man died. And then what God's assessment was, what God said, was, you fool. That man's life illustrated a foolish life. And in our mind's eye, that's not really what we visualize when we think about it. And so we need to kind of broaden our understanding here a little bit of what this verse in, let me back up, this verse in Ephesians 5, what it is talking about. It's not just talking about, you know, abusing your body and stuff like that. We need a better, fuller understanding of that. And passages like Luke chapter 12 help to give us some of that understanding. Don't live your life like that. Don't live in a foolish way. Now, here's the thing. As I've already stated, you can't back up and redo your life. There's no undo button that you can push. It doesn't work that way. But you can certainly impact the remaining days of your life. I mean, if I end up living an average lifespan, what does that mean? I've got another 20, 23 years to live in my life. I mean, you can do the math, you know, for you. I may not be able to go back and relive any of the 57 years of my life to this date, but I can do something about tomorrow. I can do something about the way that I live November and December of this year. I can do something about the way I approach 2019. You see, I do have influence on that, and so do you. Now, your the average lifespan and all this, you may only have 4 or 5 years left based on that, or you may have 20 years, or you may have 40 years, but the point of the matter is you do have some influence and you have some say in how that plays out. But the thing that kind of sneaks up behind us and has a way of kind of paralyzing us are regrets, because we become preoccupied with stuff from yesteryear. You know, there are numerous examples in the Bible of people who could have gotten preoccupied with regrets of their past because they made bad choices in their life, and it really messed things up, at least for a period of time. I think about Moses, the one that wrote Psalm 90. Remember what he did, kind of in a rash moment in his life. He ended up taking the life of an Egyptian taskmaster. And as a result of that, I mean, that was after he had lived one-third of his life, and he did that, and then he was basically on the run. He was a fugitive. You know, because the Egyptians, you know, if they would have seen his face, you know, they would have ended his life because of what he had done. And so for Moses, it could have been very easy for him while he was living out in the wilderness for the second third of his year, or his life, the second third, several years, he could have been living with regrets, kind of beating himself up mentally. Why did I do that? I made such a mess of things. And he could have basically been paralyzing himself as far as the way he was approaching life, because he couldn't get his mind off of those bad decisions that he made in a rash moment. Or you think about Paul. And we talked about Paul a couple months ago. Paul was a persecutor of the church before the whole Damascus conversion experience took place. And Paul was doing everything he could possibly do to have Christians, whether they were male or female, executed, or in the very least, thrown into prison. And he was like a one-man wrecking crew wanting to wipe Christianity off the face of the earth. But then his conversion took place. It could have been very easy for Paul to have become preoccupied with the faces of those individuals that he had thrown into prison unjustly. I mean, he could have just, the guilt could have been eating him alive. Or I think of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is described as being a chief tax collector. And so it takes him an additional step beyond like people like Matthew, who was a tax collector. Zacchaeus oversaw several other tax collectors. And tax collectors, they had a bad name in the first century because basically, though they were Jewish people, they were working for the foreign government, the Roman government, and collecting taxes from their kinsmen. And the basic rule of thumb was you have a certain quota you were to collect. Anything above and beyond that, that's your income. And tax collectors were notorious for taking advantage of that. And that's why oftentimes they were very well-to-do. They were very wealthy. Zacchaeus was very wealthy. But then he met Jesus. The whole sycamore tree and all of that kind of stuff, you know, had taken place. And he became a follower of Jesus. But it would have been very easy for him to have gotten eaten alive by regrets of the people that he had taken advantage of over the years. You see what I'm saying? And we could even take this a step further. We could even reference people that really did not make bad choices, but rather instead they were people that just kind of got the shaft in life. They were people that had things perpetrated against them that they didn't invite. They didn't do anything that caused this kind of stuff to happen. You know, I'm thinking of people like Joseph in the Bible. And remember how his brothers treated him, and his brothers ended up selling him to some traveling Midianites that were on their way to Egypt, and he got sold in Egypt as a slave. And while he was a slave in Potiphar's house, it was Potiphar's wife that trumped up some false charges against him for attempted rape, and he ends up being thrown into prison for a number of years. Joseph didn't invite any of that stuff. Joseph didn't bring that upon himself. It would have been very easy for Joseph to have had an extended, long pity party where he was fixated on how unfair life had been to him, right? He could have spent months and years just thinking of that, not thinking about opportunities or how I'm going to live my life today or next week or next month. Instead, he's totally focused on what happened in the past. It would have been easy for that to have happened. Or how about Job? Job is in the Bible is described as being a man with integrity. He really feared God, but yet what happened to him? He not only lost his health in a major way because of a disaster, he lost all of his children. They died. He lost his livestock. He lost his crops. I mean, his whole life, and his life was good. His whole life collapsed, basically exploded. And it would have been very easy for Job to have been thinking about how unfair all of this is and how he had been trying to dot every I and cross every T and do everything right. And by God's own description, that's the way Job was living his life. But yet, all of this happened to him. You see, it would be easy for us, whether it be because of bad choices that we have made in the past that still haunt us today, or whether it be because of things that were perpetrated against us that were totally out of our control, it would be really easy for us to be preoccupied with our regrets and to be consumed by pity parties so that we are not seizing the opportunity and we are not living life today and tomorrow and next week the way that someone who is wise should live it, because we're so preoccupied with yesteryear. Let me, hopefully, in helping to open our minds a little bit here, let me share with you some benefits. Some benefits from encountering struggles. Because the Bible does list, and I'm not doing an exhaustive study, but I am going to try to rapidly share with you seven benefits that come from struggles. But there's more that's actually found in the Bible. Now, again, something I think we're all kind of all on the same page in regards to, we want our lives to be trouble-free. I mean, that's just kind of human nature. We want our lives to be trouble-free. But here's the thing. God doesn't look at trouble like we do. When we see stress, God sees opportunities. When we see crisis, God sees growth, potential growth. So whether our struggles are brought upon us because of our own poor choices or whether they invade our life totally out of our control, the Bible teaches there are some benefits. Number one, these struggles teach, they drive us to God in prayer. this is a good place to begin, because prayer is always a good thing. There are multiple passages of Scripture that talk about the concept about how if you have struggles of one type or another going on in your life, you know, the last resort shouldn't be prayer. It should be the first thing that you do. James chapter 5, verses 13 and 14 says, is anyone among you suffering? He should pray. Is anyone cheerful? He should sing praises. Is anyone among you sick? He should call for the elders of the church, and they should pray over him after anointing him with olive oil in the name of the Lord. So there's a couple of times just in those two verses where it's basically saying if you're sick or if you're suffering, you know, prayer is the direction you should go, calling upon God. When everything is smooth sailing and everything's seemingly going our way, we oftentimes don't feel a need for God. But desperate times tend to lead to desperate prayer. When we feel that we're no match for whatever it is that has invaded our life, we're more apt to look for help. Okay? If we don't have anything major invading our life, self-reliance kind of kicks into high gear oftentimes. But when there's something that we feel is bigger than us, we ask people to pray, and we start praying more than ever before. That can be a very good thing, because good results can come out of that in a variety of ways. The second benefit, struggles have a way of humbling us. They humble us. Paul tells a story in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 that most all people that have seriously studied this chapter believe that he's actually referencing himself, though he doesn't specifically refer to himself as being the object of the story. But he tells about a man who had a vision that saw some things in heaven and heard some things in heaven, but that what God did was God had placed in his life a form of adversity that he describes as being a thorn. And the purpose of that was to keep him from getting a big head. Okay, this is the way the verse actually reads. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7, it says, to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and to keep me from becoming proud. Now, we don't know what the thorn in the flesh was. There are some people that actually claim that they know what it was, but I would say, yeah, it's still guesswork. They really don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us specifically what it was. But we know what Paul's attitude about it was, is that, first of all, he thought it was tormenting him. It was very unpleasant. And I believe just by the urgency of his prayer and the fact that he prayed multiple times that God would take it from his life, that Paul felt like it was getting in the way of him being a faithful servant for the Lord in accomplishing the types of things that he needed to accomplish. But anyway, what I wanted you to see here is that he is pointing out that this struggle, whatever type of struggle it is, served a purpose of keeping him humble. And that's one of the things that trials and hardships, it has a way of doing that, has a way of reminding us of how fragile we are. Number three, dealing with that same passage of Scripture, struggles, they make us stronger. Paul goes on, and after he says, I prayed three times about this, and God said no, but then God said more than that. This is what the way it reads in verse 9. The Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness. Well, then here's Paul's reaction to that, his attitude. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. When we realize how powerless we are, that's when we lean on him more than ever before in our life, resulting in strength that we could have never mustered on our own. We end up being stronger as a person than we could have ever been if just left to ourselves. But it's because we're leaning upon him and we're drawing upon his strength, okay? His power. The word there is dunamis, where we get the English word dynamite for power. It's his power that starts making a difference in our life. The fourth benefit our struggles can produce is they help us understand God's word better. In the longest chapter of the Bible, Psalm 119, we have this verse. Verse 71 says, "My troubles turned out all for the best. They forced me to learn from your textbook." Okay, that's from the Message. So that's a paraphrase. But if you look in your translation, you're going to see something very similar to that, just slightly different terminology. But the psalmist is basically saying there that my troubles actually accomplished some good things in my life. And among the things that they accomplished is they helped me to understand the Word better, God's statutes better. It helped open my eyes. That's kind of the point that is being made. Adversity has a way of opening our eyes and opening our hearts to see the Word of God more clearly than ever before. But it's actually more than that, because the psalm writer, previous to that, a couple of verses earlier in verse 67, said, "Before I was afflicted, before the struggles came into my life, I went astray, but now I keep your word." And basically, by his own admission, he's saying, because of the difficulties I've been going through in my life, I am more consistent spiritually in my life. Before, I had a relatively loose grip on things as far as my attachment to the Lord, but now I'm holding a lot tighter to the Lord. There's more consistency and there's less straying that is taking place. The fifth benefit that we see, and this is one that some of you already thought about, is the concept of comfort. When we go through struggles in our life, part of what we're promised as believers in the Bible is that God's comfort will come into our life. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 says it like this: "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our afflictions, so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." Basically, what Paul is saying is that when you go through a rough stretch as a believer, when you go through a rough stretch in your life, it is during that time, during that grief, during that pain, that God's Spirit is able to bring healing and wholeness into your life. Though you may feel crushed, you may feel broken, God is able to bring healing to you. He's able to, in some incredible sort of a way, he's able to bring an inner calm into your life, even though you're in the midst of a storm. That's the kind of stuff that he's talking about here. But he goes on, if reading that whole passage, and you see that it basically is saying that that's not intended to be an end in itself. Yes, God brings comfort into your life during the dark days of whatever it is, whatever the struggle is that you're going through. But as an end result, when you come out the other side of that struggle, now you are better equipped to be able to reach into the lives of others and be used by God to bring comfort to them. For example, let's use depression as an example. Let's say that you're going through, for whatever reason, a period of time where the days seem really dark. There's a cloud that just seems to follow you everywhere. There's no light at the end of the tunnel. You know, all of those terms that are used sometimes to describe depression. Let's say you go through an extended period of time of depression, and it's during that time that God is ministering to your spirit through his Spirit by bringing comfort, by bringing a wholeness, a sense of calm into your life in the middle of all the turbulent thoughts and stuff that are going on. Well, after going through that through an extended period of time, you come out the other side of that, and sometime later, it's a coworker or it's a close friend of yours that for whatever reason starts going into a similar tunnel, a similar form of darkness in their life of depression. Now, all of a sudden, you can empathize with them more, and you are better equipped to be able to minister to them. See, that not only applies in regards to depression, that can apply to a jobless situation, financial struggles, that can apply to marital struggles or even a divorce, that can apply to a diagnosis in a doctor's office that's about the worst news that you could hear, you know, and then you come out the other side of that, and now you know someone else that gets a similar diagnosis. You see, you're in a position that God now, in a form of speaking, has equipped you to be able to minister to them in a greater way than you could have ever otherwise. Okay, so that's one of the benefits of encountering struggles, is it brings God's comfort. Number six, they produce perseverance and character in us. And this is probably the passage that more people in here thought about than any of the others under these seven items. And one of the reasons may be because out of all of them, this is probably the passage I've talked about more over the years than the others. It's James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. It says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." So it's not saying that you need to have some kind of a cheesy grin on your face, you know, when some bad thing starts invading your life and you start suffering or struggling or having marital problems or something, and all of a sudden now you should be bubbly and cheery and in the midst. That's not what that passage is saying. That passage is saying is that there's something much more deep-seated in you that you know God's going to do something with this. That God's ways are higher than your ways. And that God, in some incredible, mysterious way, he is going to use this in a positive way. And one of those ways is he's going to be hammering and shaping and molding you more into the likeness of his son. As much as we would prefer to live a trouble-free life, it is in the midst of struggles and trials that real growth happens. Just as gold is refined by fire, so faith is purified by adversity. Now, gold, I haven't read any reports that says that gold has nerve endings. Okay, I don't think it does. But imagine if gold had nerve endings, how painful of a process, you know, the refining by fire would be. But yet for gold to have value, it needs to be refined. It needs to go through the fire. Well, yeah, though gold might not have nerve endings, you do have nerve endings, and I do too. So it is a painful process for us when we go through adversity of whatever type it is. But the outcome of it can be a very positive thing. It's not something that has to make us bitter. It can make us better. And that's the point that passage is saying. Easy street isn't where Christ's likeness is forged. That's not where growth happens the most. And then we got number seven, the benefit of struggles. They remind us that this world is not our home. That's a biggie. Affliction has a way of weaning us from this world. In 1987, when I went through the junk that I went through with my cancer, there was one particular passage of Scripture that took on special meaning above all other passages, and it quickly became my favorite passage in the days and years that followed, and I'd say that it's still probably my favorite passage in the Bible. It was something that ministered and meant a great deal to me then, but it's still something that provides a world of perspective for me even today. And it's this. Okay, I know that's a small font, but hopefully you can see that. 2 Corinthians 4, verses 16 to 18 says, "Therefore we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away," which I felt like I was wasting away in 87. "Yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles," now most people wouldn't think stage 4 cancer, and chemo is light and momentary. But the contrast he's making here is he's contrasting it to the glory of eternity, okay? So it doesn't even compare. So light and momentary is appropriate terminology. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. It has so much to do with perspective and a recognition of the fact that this world is not our home. The body that you're in right now, that you're inhabiting right now, that wasn't intended to be a permanent body. It's just for the time being. You will receive an immortal body one day due to your faith in the Lord, which the Bible talks a lot about in places like 1 Corinthians 15. And that's part of what suffering and adversity and all, it helps remind us that the here and now and what I'm experiencing in my life, this isn't the sum total of my existence. I'm going to spend a whole lot more time on the other side than what I am going to spend here. Suffering has a way of reminding us of that, that this world is temporary, and what is on the horizon is eternal. Yeah, jumping in a time machine and going back in time and somehow tweaking this and tweaking that in order to avoid certain present-day adversities and suffering and stuff like that, there is something appealing to that. But the reality of the matter is, in view of these things that we're talking about here that are represented in Scripture, you know, even if that was possible to jump in a time machine and to change the past, the end result is you wouldn't be the person that you are today. So those nine people that answered that connection card in that way, whether they were thinking it or not, they were actually right on course to understanding certain conclusions that the Scripture presents to us. That God uses adversity in our life. He uses it for good. And like I said earlier, we don't have to become bitter as a result. And we don't have to spend all of our time in a pity party about it. Rather, we can become better people, and we can be closer to the Lord than ever before. Do you have certain regrets about the past? Sure, you do, and I do too. There are some things in our past, as we look back over our shoulders, that, that was wrong, shouldn't have done that, bad decision on my part or on your part. But you see, that's where passages like this come into play. Romans 8:28. And this is your memory verse this week. We know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. That verse does not say that God causes all things. It's saying that God causes all things to work together for good. So whatever the pain, whatever the ordeal, whatever the adversity is that you might be encountering even right now at this moment, God, you can't pin that on God that he's caused that. But what you can know is God will use that to his glory and for your betterment, for your growth. We may not always understand how that's going to be possible, but again, God's ways are above our ways. Our ushers are going to be getting up at this time, preparing for our communion. And while they're making those preparations, let me just say that I've often thought over the years of Moses and how Moses must have struggled. Because the way his life is laid out, it's laid out in three periods of time. He lived a long, full life. In that first period of time, he grew up in all the comforts of Egypt, all the privilege of Egypt. But then he did what he did in that rash moment where he took someone's life, and then he was a fugitive, and he was living out in the wilderness and ended up connecting with a shepherding family and became a part of that. And that's how he spent several years, a number of years, shepherding sheep, which from an Egyptian's perspective, that was like the lowest of low type of occupations you could have had in the way you could have spent your time. But yet, that's what Moses' life was. And I wonder how often Moses, as he was wandering here or there in the wilderness, trying to find a little grass to keep his sheep fed, I wonder how many times the thoughts were going through his mind, why did I do that? How many times he might have been kicking himself, you know, for such poor judgment and figuring he really made a mess of things. He made a major mess of his life. You see, because during that period of time, he had no clue what the future held for him. We read his life, and we know what all three time segments involve. Because the third time segment, an equal number of years of each of the others, God used him to deliver the Hebrews out of bondage where they had been for 400 years in Egypt and freed them, the parting of the Red Sea, the giving of all the commandments at Mount Sinai, and Moses guided them in their wilderness wanderings, which he would have known the wilderness like the back of his hand, because that's where he spent so much of his time for the previous years. You see, God, unbeknownst to Moses, had been preparing him in ways that he was equipped to be used by God. I say that to say this. Right now, you might be going through some kind of an ordeal in your life, and you may feel like your head is spinning, okay? You may just have many regrets regarding this or that, and if you're not careful, you're gonna kind of fall into paralysis of a permanent pity party, or bitterness is going to get the upper hand in your life. The thing I want you to recognize is that God can and God will use whatever this adversity, whatever this struggle is that you're going through. He will use that not only to his glory, but he will use that to your betterment in your life. That is what the Bible teaches. We don't need a time machine. We need a better understanding of the God that we serve.
Okay. Hi, I'm Tracy. I'm the operations pastor here at Crossroads Christian Church, and I want to take a moment just to say thank you to all of you who are taking some time to watch this message. In just a moment, we'll be sharing this week's announcements. But in the meantime, if you're a visitor, we want to thank you for joining us virtually this morning. We encourage you to take a moment to visit our website for more information. You can find the link to our website in the description just above in this video. And we hope you'll consider joining us Sunday or possibly even at one of our upcoming events. For those of you who call Crossroads home, we want to extend the opportunity to continue your worship through giving. You'll find another link up in the description that will allow you to give of your tithes and offerings through our website. Thanks again, and we hope to see you here next Sunday.
Well, we have come to a part in our service where we will be receiving our tithes and our offerings. It's certainly a time for us to acknowledge God and for his goodness and his greatness and his generosity to us. If you're visiting with us today, we invite you to pass the tray on by and allow this service to be our gift to you. And as the offering is being received, let me share with you some announcements. And all of these are in your bulletin, so I'll just highlight them for a little bit and draw your attention to them. But many of you are aware that this evening from 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock, we have Trunk or Treat. And a lot of folks have signed up to host a trunk out here in our parking lot. And that's a good thing. We appreciate everyone that's doing that. And many of you have also contributed candy to that. And our goal is to get rid of all of that candy by the end of this evening. So, but we will have a lot of kids and a lot of families walking through our parking lot tonight. So just be in prayer that this would be a great time for them and for their families. And that perhaps through this evening they'll become a little bit more familiar with Crossroads and Christ and the new life that we have in Jesus. So keep that in mind for tonight. We have our next Closer Look class scheduled for November the 3rd. It's a class that's designed to help those specifically who are newer to Crossroads to get to know us, what we teach, why we do the things that we do, and some of the other behind-the-scenes things. So if you've never attended that class, even if you've been coming for some time, we encourage you to sign up for that class. It goes from 9 o'clock to 1 o'clock on Saturday, and we'll feed you lunch if you'll come, but it'll be a great time of just getting to know Crossroads and us a chance to get to know you a little bit better as well. Then we have prime time coming up on November the 7th, and that begins at 7 o'clock. And as we've been talking about, the purpose of this prime time is to recognize and honor and celebrate Harvey and Nancy Backus and their many years of ministry, particularly the last 12 years or so, leading Books and More Ministry and a man, Jordan. So we encourage you to come out that evening for that celebration and be part of what we do to honor them. You can come early at 6:30 for the meal, but we do need you to sign up for that because we're going to be catering a part of that meal. So keep that in mind and sign up as quickly as you could for that, if you would, please. So keep that in mind. We hope that you'll be here on the 7th as a part of that celebration. Let's stand together and pray together and just ask the Lord God to bless us as we go out into the world today. Our gracious, mighty Father, thank you so much that we have Jesus Christ to look to for our inspiration, for our purpose in life. And we recognize, Lord, that every one of us have had failings and shortcomings and some pretty big mistakes, perhaps, in our life. But the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses those sins all from our lives. And you give us a new heart, a new purpose, a new goal in life. And we pray that each and every day we would be able to follow you and submit to you and trust in you in every aspect of our life. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity that we have to begin anew and to share this grace and this mercy with the people around us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you for being here. Have an